Where the severity of deterioration requires replacement of a distinctive feature, the new feature shall match the old in design, color, texture, and other visual qualities, and where possible, materials. Replacement of missing features shall be substantiated by documentary, physical, or pictorial evidence. You want to just explain your project, why you have done what you did so far?
The reason why is I had to change it the way it was before is because the ratings were very, very low. And it was a huge danger for kids to reside in that building. Besides that, there were many spindles were loose, so I had to raise it, which I felt was safe, which is 40 inches. So that's what we did, we raised it. And now that we want to finish raising all of them, we didn't do anything, just the ones which were in serious danger, not because they were loose completely, but we want to raise everything to 40 inches high. And then we would like to paint and scrape the spindles and the entire exterior of the park. Just the woodwork, not the stone or anything else.
And repaint it?
Yes.
Do you know you purchased the property in a historic district?
Correct.
You know you did that? Okay. You know you're in a historic district, okay. Did you pull a building permit for the city before you started this project?
The base of the buildings, no. But I knew I had to pull if I want to choose paint. And, you know.
And you need one for the railings.
I didn't know that.
Okay.
I wasn't aware of that. No.
Requires 36 inches. Yes.
Okay.
And currently, the original way it was 31 inches diameter. So it was even less than code requires, which, you know, I'm trying to be safe.
We have an idea when the railings were added to that building.
Mm-hmm. We thought about that in an executive session.
You know, even if I leave it the way it is, it's surprising that the city should allow. I mean, I don't know if it's a responsibility of the city, but me as an owner, I'm responsible in case someone falls on that building.
Yeah, so there's balconies all over. There's another balcony property down the street from you on the other block that,
which is
I
awesome.
Think they're 36,
wow.
Between 31 and 36 inches.
Well, as long as I can remember, that has always been that way.
Yeah.
It has always looked the same way. I can't ever remember not seeing it that way, so.
Let me ask you this. Did you ever think about taking all the porches down completely?
No.
No. It's not original to the property. That's why.
No, it's not.
No.
Just when was it built?
I have a postcard of what it originally looked like.
Did you say
1902 is when your property was built. This is from the postmark on is 1915. But I was just curious if you would consider taking them down completely.
No.
Okay.
I know the property was long known as the Brossman Apartments because of the builder, Adam Brossman, who built my house also. And if you're interested, school teacher, prison warden, home builder. That was his career.
Wow.
So that's a little odd choice of path going to home builder. But like I said, knowing, I don't know if he was actually the one responsible for the railings going up or not. I mean, that I'm not aware of whether he was or not. So he died in 1923, I think it was. So maybe, I don't know. But he did live at
501.
He did live at 503 over. That's where he passed away. That's where he did. So.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. I'm just talking. And the spindle width was.
2.5,
and you've changed it to 1.25.
Okay. Aaron, there's many railings throughout the city that are still, like, I don't want to say they're grandfathered, but they're still at the low original historic height. Is it only required to change it when somebody's doing like a major renovation and there's a certain percentage of the renovation is being done?
Only if it's being modified.
Okay.
So if he pulls a building permit to replace these railings, would code say, or would the building and trades, would they say they have to be at 36 inches if they're replacing all of it?
If it's a repair, then they can match existing.
Right.
It's a replacement, yeah.
Because of the fact that they're historic. If it's a replacement, then they have to meet the new code.
Just 36.
Well, when you say I have to meet code, but I'm allowed to go higher?
Mm-hmm. Okay. As long as the board
approves. As long as,
okay.
Yeah, we would have to approve that.
Okay. If 36 is safe, I don't mind doing it at a height.
I mean, that's the code.
So
if you could pull the building permit, that's where we would have alleviated all of this. And so once we approve whatever, then you're going to have to go pull a building permit.
Okay.
And then they will tell you to what exactly they're going to require of you.
Okay.
As far as the height. And if what Mr. Booth says is correct, then he can go. If it's a full replacement, then they're going to require 36.
Right. I don't know if you could classify as full replacement because you're still using the top and bottom rail. Is that right? The top.
If they're in good condition.
Okay. So far, with the ones that you have referenced, have you used the rails?
Yes.
That you have. Okay.
Just the top one, but that is really. I don't think that's any different nowadays. The one which is there right now, I don't think if you want to buy a new one, it's going to be any different.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
Basically, it's a full replacement.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, it's hard to tell from that photo, postcard, but I would imagine even the balusters around first floor at the front are probably not original.
Right.
You mean in the
current
yes,
state.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I would agree.
Yeah, these look like they're
spindle. I mean, if they were original, I imagine they would have more detail than just these square posts.
Those
are the only ones left. And then I have another picture where the railing starts with the square spindles. You can see an outline of this on the post. You can tell that those were.
Sides are probably the original. Front is.
These rounded are original.
So this address is on your deed, it's just 701 North Fifth Street, correct?
Yes.
And the county tax parcels or assessment parcel viewer is listing it as 701A in our system. Yeah. But it is 701.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank
I don't
you.
Know why that A is in
I wonder if there was a there was just a porch that came around. That porch roof came on.
Who's done the work for you thus far? Do you have a licensed contractor that's been doing this work for you?
My management company.
Okay.
As their employee.
Okay.
Which does it.
Okay. Are they licensed to work in the city? Do you know? Yes. Okay.
It was a true in-kind replacement. 2.5-inch balusters. It would be a review at that level. Being that it's a change to the proportions, now we have to consider the appropriateness against the standards, which I don't know that an 1.25-inch square baluster would be historically appropriate. I would think if anything of a turn baluster would be appropriate. It's just the height is going to be different than what would have existed originally.
So the existing
baluster, that balustrade that is the 2.5 in the square, you know, at a 36 inch height, do you think would be appropriate or?
Not in my opinion.
Okay.
Yeah, I think 1.25 inches is smaller than most of the balusters. I mean, unless they're wrought iron, but
right.
Wood balusters, I can't even think of a property that has a baluster that narrow.
Yeah, but I mean, like if he were to replace, just basically take the existing porch that's there and then get the same proportion of the baluster, but at 36 inches, the 2.5.
Yeah. I mean, that would be more.
Okay, just a code height. Yeah.
But my recommendation would be
something
this is an opportunity now. Mm-hmm. The balusters are all changing.
Yeah.
To use a turned baluster.
I don't think you can get those these days.
You can.
Yes?
Mm-hmm.
Any recommendation, Wade?
Because
the one I've used now, that's the regular symbols which they use nowadays. Porch.
Yeah, but this is in a historic district.
Okay,
we don't.
So
yeah.
Any recommendation with it?
So there's an artifacts bank right next door to you.
Yeah.
They're open Sundays and Mondays. They can give you suggestions. There's a lot of people that turn these still.
Mm-hmm.
There's a man that's in, I think, Kutztown. Right. The cards are all on the inside of the building on a bulletin board there. And Mike Lauder, who's the executive director of Center Park, where your property is, can lead you in the right direction with that, if that's what the board decides to.
And even though this wasn't original, you know, why would I be allowed to go to the...
Well, we haven't made the decision yet, so... We try to keep the integrity of the properties. And since those spindles are already on the front porch of what would have been there, is everybody looking at the picture of the property right now? That was a question. So if you look at the picture that I'm looking at, the Fish Street side, you see this railing right here?
Yes.
See that there?
Yeah.
This railing here?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is that spindles? Are those confirmed?
This one.
Down here.
Is that true?
Yeah. All right.
Yes.
So there are some original spindles on there then.
What about this railing?
That wasn't even brought up.
And by the way, I wouldn't even change the first floor. The first floor I would leave because that's safe. I would only change the top two floors.
Looks like the top is worn.
I'm like a bomb that's been there.
So you're not changing the lower ones, just the second and third floor.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's.
And I would use the spindles, you know, which are spare from the top floors to preserve the bottom ones. So, you know, it stays some of the
for repairing.
Yeah.
You
know, there are a few missing from the
bottom. Yeah, I can see that. Yeah. That we may include that in our motion.
I actually happen to like it, but you know.
What if we had him take this down, put something like that in, then this up?
Yeah. I think that would typically have been, you know, those would have been turned, or would have been like a wrought iron post, you know, handrail. Typically from the street line, even the steps are.
I see steps, but I don't see when
the steps are like pressure.
Yeah. You see that?
Yeah.
They didn't need railings though.
Yeah. Typically though, they're usually wrought iron, typically. from the street,
mm-hmm.
from the sidewalk.
Yeah,
to the part of the house. Yeah. So then the question remains, like, if he is not intending to change the first floor, how does that impact our decision for the, you know, the spindles and balustrade for the second and the third floor?
I have a question. This piece between the first floor roof and the second floor floor, what is that in there? Is that metal or is that wood?
Well, the fire escape?
No, no. This white strip that goes across here?
The sections just
yes.
below your railing.
What is that?
The section between each floor.
Yeah.
That's wood. That's wood. And I would leave that because I think all of them are in good shape. You know, we have to preserve it, you know, maybe nail it and paint it. But it's wood, yeah.
It looks like a bead board or just planks
yeah.
or something to me. Yeah.
Are you going to paint the fire escape?
For sure.
What color were you thinking?
I was thinking of just the ones which I kept, let me know, black for the fire escape and gray for the entire woodwork.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah, the black is okay for the fire escape. And normally staff approves paint colors, but I did show this to the executive committee that he wants to paint the woodwork gray, and they recommended using like a warmer taupe gray color. So I did inform the owner that, or asked if you would reconsider.
Honestly, I wouldn't mind to paint it the color it is right now.
That's
I was thinking gray is like more up to date in a certain way. It's more attractive. I like the color gray personally. I think the interior everything gray these days.
Yeah, we saw the pictures.
So that's what I was thinking. But you know, I was actually debating myself if the gray is going to match with the dark brown and the light brown stone. It's just more towards the inside, you know, the actual brick of the building. But again, I can paint it the color it is right now. I have nothing against it.
To match the
yeah, the stone is very
stone.
Exactly. Yeah.
The stone set brown, I would agree that it would stay.
Yeah.
And you're gonna paint the back here?
That's a different story, which I'm not applying right now. You know, I first want to see the porches in shape,
mm-hmm.
and then I'll go to that. And that's also a desire, you know.
That's what?
Preservation. It's, I need to do it, except it's just I want to do things step by step. You know, we can discuss it right now, because I would like to know what I'm allowed to do on that part, but that particular part is completely woodwork, and I would like to ask, you know, if I can do it, cover it with I'll be recording at home. But I know, no,
we don't allow vinyl and historic effort.
What other options?
Yeah, and like you said, I mean, I'm not gonna. I just wanted to know if you were going to paint what was existing there. Ms. Johnson can review that with you when you
okay.
put an application in for that.
Okay.
What are the dimensions of the top and bottom rail? Do we have that information?
No, because he was reusing the existing, so I didn't ask him for that.
Mr. Booth, did you see in this picture here, there's spindles turned here, and then this is the same as the second and third floor? I would like to see that match this.
I thought he wasn't proposing to change the first floor.
What I was going to recommend is that we could move this up.
Wait,
that's
the turned?
Yeah.
Oh.
Have new turned put in here and use this up there. That the board decides to.
I think that's too low though, isn't it? Isn't that existing? The square is.
Only if it's at 31 inches, isn't it?
It's 31, but that's too low. We move it up.
If we move it up.
If we move it up,
yeah.
Is that what you were suggesting to move it up? Okay.
Oh, 36, you mean?
Yeah.
From 31. No.
Okay.
But it depends on the building permit of what they.
Well, as a replacement, it sounds like 36 would be required.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
True. So then we can't decide.
Yeah, I think it's too low. Yeah.
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 Yeah. Anybody else have any questions?
I would make a motion, but I don't know if the board would be in agreement with it. We'll see. My motion would be to deny the certificate of appropriateness for 701 North 5th Street. And that the recommendation would be to resubmit a baluster design that is either matching in kind with the existing baluster at the code approved height, or a turned baluster, a 3-inch turned baluster that is appropriate to the width of the top and bottom rail and historically appropriate as determined by the staff. And I can provide some assistance. Ms. Johnson needs some recommendations from the manufacturers.
Did you say a 3-inch turn?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
It's coming to 2.5. Okay. Referring to the width of this number?
Yes.
It's currently 2.5.
Correct. Yes.
Okay. Why do you say 3?
So that would be for a new baluster design. So there's two options in that recommendation. One option is to match what you have now, which is 2.5.
Okay.
Second option would be to have a new baluster design that's 3 inches. And that would be a turned baluster.
What's a turned baluster?
It's shaped on a lathe.
Like what you have on your first floor, but thinner than that. Taller and thinner.
So instead of a flat piece of wood that's cut on a table saw, It's actually from a rectangular extrusion that's turned on a lathe and use that lathe to shape the curved profile.
And we have a lot of those at the Artifacts Bank already. I don't know if you'll find that many, but and there are, like I said, there are people that can make those.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
It would have to be at the right height. Yeah.
Right.
How about I was thinking if I take the gate the way it is. I lift it to 36 inches. So all which remains is a gap from the bottom. And I put maybe a thin piece of wood or some kind of mesh just to cover so no one slips through.
I don't think that would be an appropriate change to what's there.
Or code.
Yeah.
I don't know what code.
Yeah, I'm not sure code would agree with that either.
The building code will not allow passage of a 4-inch sphere. There can't be an opening larger than 4 inches. And that's for
and it has
size
to be something between, let's say, a piece of metal or whatever. piece of wood.
I don't know if I've ever seen that. That's not something that we've come across before, but I doubt that would be determined historically appropriate.
Yeah, that would be getting into that part there now with the scope.
Well, so, we have a motion.
Yeah, I'll second that.
Oh, before we do anything, did you have any comment on the paint color? I realize that's not typically something that the board would discuss. Do you want to put that back to the preservation officer or just up?
I would include that with the staff level.
Okay.
Anything about this railing? Did you see this?
No, because it's being proposed for replacement.
So that would be separate?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
A separate violation?
Oh, that railing.
What, the steps to go up?
Yeah, that.
That has been since I bought the building.
Mm-hmm.
No changes, I've made nothing to that.
No idea how long that's
okay.
Been there. I mean, it's not installed correctly. It's, would you be willing to work with us or if I can help you like find something that's more appropriate? Like it just looks like 2x4.
Yeah, I just don't know
what probably.
There's a rail, there's a wrought iron railing on the front of the building.
Yeah.
They were installed throughout the city in
the 50s
or 60s. I have one.
Yeah.
That could be used. Pipe rail could be used.
Pipe rail, very popular in the city.
Yeah.
And there's other stairs that don't have
railing.
I would like to add something there because she's been complaining.
Okay.
So
that would be a separate application.
Yeah.
But maybe at that time when you're changing this, We can do that one too. And usually, as Mr. Booth stated, wrought iron railings are historically appropriate. And I can give you some ideas of what
I would like to, because the sooner I can get it done, I would like to do it.
Okay. No, I can help you with that.
Yeah, all these things are part of an application process.
Okay.
So back to the motion.
Okay.
Mr. Booth has made a motion.
I second it.
Okay. Ms. Waller?
Yes.
Mr. Booth?
Yes.
Mr. Politica?
Yes.
Okay. All right, Ms. Johnson, we'll be in touch with you and review the motion and what will be expected of you as far as what we propose tonight.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Nice evening. Yeah. All right. Second one on the agenda is 1710. Benny.
Yes.
Going to be 1710 Hampton Boulevard. If you could please sign in.
So he speaks English, so what do you would like assistance in case there's something that's not understand?
So I can just read and if he can just ask you if he has. Okay, perfect. So this is 1710 Hampton Boulevard, and this is a newer constructed property. This one-story modular home was constructed in 2006 and is not a contributing site in the Heights Conservation District. And tonight we are reviewing the proposal for the construction of a carport that has been constructed, and this was reviewed by the HARD in October 2022, at which time the review was tabled. And the Secretary of the Interior standards that apply to this project are number 9, new additions, exterior alterations, or related new construction shall not destroy historic materials that characterize the property. The new work shall be differentiated from the old and shall be compatible with the massing, size, scale, and architectural features to protect the historic integrity of the property and its environment. And number 10, new additions and adjacent or related new construction shall be undertaken in such a manner that if removed in the future, the essential form and integrity of the historic property and its environment would be unimpaired. And just an extra added note, I did, and it's in your executive committee notes, but I did speak with the zoning office, and the carport as it exists right now meets the zoning ordinance. So as soon as the, or if the HARB approves it, they would be able to issue a zoning permit, yes.
And can you just really quickly, what was the language why we tabled this? Do you have that?
Yes.
Okay, it's the resolution. Just as a refresher, everybody's
So it was tabled as installed, pending further investigation with the zoning administrator and investigation of prior HARB approvals of temporary structures. There was just more discussion about it, whether it's considered a temporary structure versus a permanent structure, but it's not attached to the house. The owner is not going to remove it as long as you live there, correct? I think that's what you stated. And the only one that I could remember and found that the carport that the board had approved previously was one on Madison Avenue, which was much smaller than this one, but it was considered a permanent structure as well. So one of the issues is within the height, the historic district ordinance in the conservation district section, it does not specifically call out that carports do not need or don't require a certificate of appropriateness or review by the board. But other temporary, like accessory elements,
A shed
is not right in the language, but it was determined to be an accessory element and does not require review.
Okay. I'm just trying to think what it's most likely, what it's most akin to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nope, that's I forgot about that part. Thank you.
And it's like, it's not like it's the structure, it's also the size as well, even though that does, it does meet the zoning requirement, right? It doesn't, it doesn't violate the,
And it's due to the fact that his plot of land is.
That what it's relative to?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Fine. Said per section 600-802.A of the zoning ordinance, the maximum building coverage is 2,575 square feet or 30%, and the maximum impervious coverage is 40%. She has calculated, she said, with the addition of the driveway and carport, the building coverage would be 1,527 square feet, which is only 18%, and you can have as much as 30. And the impervious coverage would be 2,837 square feet at 33%. So they're both lower than the requirements.
It looks like the framing modifications from the previous resolution were made in addition.
Yes,
so
yes,
sometimes.
Yes.
Yeah. Unless somebody disagrees with me, I don't really see anything in the language in the for the conservation district that would prohibit this shed. I think the size of it is very large in proportion to the structure that's there, but I don't see any language that I can really look at and say, hey, this prohibits this installation of a shed and a shed of this size. I don't know if anybody wants to counter or disagree with me.
I don't have any disagreement.
Yeah, I mean, I do think it does call into an opportunity for us to maybe better find some of the language now that we're seeing more applications and we're, you know, you just can't possibly state every possible, situation or scenario that a homeowner might want to do. But I just don't think there's anything lined right now that we can actually predict with this.
And
even though,
like I said, with this being a temporary, not attached to the
right,
building.
It's not attached, right?
You know, for however long Mr. Hand has decided to live there, and he lives there for 20 years and for 30 years, and when you leave, the next person that comes in wants to, when we make our decisions with a lot of this stuff, that we have to think about that kind of stuff also as well.
And
especially when it's permanent stuff, but in your instance, it's not permanent, it's away from the building. So the very next person that comes in there, whenever that would be, could easily decide to want to take it down,
right.
And no one's going to really have too much of a problem with that.
I think
so.
I would agree. It's installation of an accessory element of ancillary nature, which doesn't require a certificate.
Okay. And then, even though it's not necessarily application, could we just talk about the progress at work on your addition? It appears as if you did make the changes that the HARD recommended.
Yeah.
We appreciate that very much, but it's very open and it doesn't appear to be clad with anything. So can you just give us an idea of when you'll complete this? I think it's problematic for your neighborhood and your neighbors, and it would be beneficial for you to secure this room. But can you tell us what the construction schedule is on this?
Well, I'm still working on it, and the only concern to me is because, you know, the way I do by myself and with my brother, and sometimes do I have to work on Sundays, you know, and it's a little hard for me. But I would like to see if I can find any other person to help me to get this done as soon as I can. I did a couple of changes. I don't know if I want to, let me see if I got the pictures I can show you right now. See, yeah, we did a couple of, let me see.
There is one change that I noticed at our meeting that I wanted to ask about. In the resolution, it says the windows proposed to be installed on the northern and southern facades of the building addition are to be installed at the same height or elevation as those on the western facade after the above required modifications, which he did make the modifications. But in
there were other windows.
This, in the original, the windows are the same height, but in this one, now these are
larger windows. So it appears as if you changed. Do you know what it looks like on the northern? You changed the size of the windows. You made approach.
I remember when they took these dust, when they told me to to remove a little more down, that's what we do. We use a 2x6 and then we put a little more down.
I think that change is appropriate. We were talking about these windows because when we had your photos from October, they were the same size as these, but these appear to be larger windows.
We're working on it because with what we're doing now, I got to take this down and take the sun side from this one, to using the both side. So I will try. I'm gonna leave those two.
Okay. So all right. So it will match the height.
It will match
okay.
with the height. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
So these will be changed to match this height.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Because the point is when I buy those windows, I don't know how big it is or how small it is. So when I saw this, I said no, that's too tall. I said no,
okay.
you need to. But I'm gonna remove it.
Yeah.
The sensor that I have in
okay.
the platform.
Because code doesn't code have a requirement from the bottom of the window to the,
yeah.
to the floor to the
bedroom? If it's a bedroom.
It's a bedroom? Okay, I see. All right.
Okay. I put the new ones in.
Okay.
So they will all be, definitely all be the same height
yes.
now.
Yes.
But they'll
the
be
shorter,
the tall.
Yes.
The shorter ones. Or taller.
The tall, they'll be the taller ones?
The one that I told you, that's the one on the side, yeah, we're going to remove that one to use the same side of the one that we have in the front.
Okay, so
they'll be shorter.
They will be short, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because I saw this too low, and I was thinking about the keys, you know, because
okay.
for me, it's not the same.
Okay, so it'll be a shorter.
I've got to be, yes. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Only one thing you did before Christmas.
I didn't see any other changes. That was the only one.
So, do we need to make a motion about the hardware test?
We don't, right? Doesn't sound like it requires any approval.
Yes.
Yeah.
We only tabled it for those reasons.
Right. Right.
So just write it up as a discussion as no motion.
Right.
Yes,
so just COA that's
this
point. Either being it's not getting tabled, there's no COA that's getting issued or denied.
Right.
Yeah.
That's true.
And the addition is not under review. We're just simply asking him for a status on that.
Right.
Okay.
That's true.
Yeah. All right. Everybody agree with that?
Yep.
Yep.
That sounds good. All right.
Okay, sir. You're
sure.
the board does not have to vote. You want to tell us? Okay. Does not have to vote on the carport. So,
okay.
But the condition is acceptable. Zoning has approved it, and we as a board don't have to issue a certificate of appropriateness. So it's appropriate. We would ask you. This is not an official motion. But we would ask you to really try to make completing that addition, closing it up, try to make that a priority for for your
yeah.
family and for the neighborhood, please.
Understand
yeah.
that.
Okay. All right.
I'll still working on it.
Okay. Good.
And I got a question about the carport. If I decide move, if I want to take it with me, do I have to come here again and or
no,
just
take it
with
you? Yep.
Okay, that's good.
Yep.
I have a question.
Yeah,
he has a building permit for that addition.
Yes.
How long did that building permit go for?
Oh, I hope they give me 1 year.
I think it's a year.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. And he just got it in March.
I'll get him. Yes.
Okay.
But like I said, believe me, I want to get this done. As soon as I can, but I gotta find another person to get this done.
Okay.
As soon as I can.
Yeah, because you have all the approvals. There's nothing other than
I know that.
Time and money, the big things that are keeping you from doing it. So
labor too.
Yeah. Well, time, money, labor, labor, money.
Oh, believe me, now
yeah.
the labor is. It's dispensable.
Yeah, I know it is.
Yeah.
yeah.
That's
yeah.
why I
yep.
tried to do a couple of things
right.
on my hand.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah. I know
yep.
they came to me right away, tried to
yep.
take my hand. So.
Yes. Okay. All right.
So,
all
right.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Yep.
Thank
you.
Thank you
very
thank
much.
You.
Yeah.
Yes.
Have a good night.
And there was no
okay.
Perfect.
So there's no voting required
right.
for the position
right.
or
no. no nothing yep
thank
and that wasn't even technically
thank you for your assistance
thank,
so,
you.
Thank you.
Does the board have an issue if I since there's no representative here from Spruce Street, I'd like to skip to item number 4
yeah.
which is 601 Penn Street
yeah.
I'll try to skip really. Come on
yeah.
up, make sure you sign in when you come up. Thanks.
This is for 601 Penn Street. It's located in the Callow Hill District, Historic District. This commercial brick building is 10 stories on the east side and 2 stories on the west. On the taller portion of the building, ribbons of windows on each floor are divided by brick piers. The 2-story portion of the building has large windows also separated by brick piers. There's a canopy over the entry on Penn Street, and it is a late modern in style and was built in 1975. And tonight we are reviewing the proposal for the installation of a 2-foot by 6-inch square blade sign to read Santander ATM in white letters on a red brown background with the logo to be located at the first floor southern facade. And the Secretary of the Interior standards that apply to this project are number 2 and 5, of which I read earlier, and the hard sign policy. If you want to
could you tell us your name?
Anna Hemingway.
Okay. And you work at the branch there or
no, I work for Image One, the sign.
Okay.
So this member signed me this.
Be a test there.
Santander wants to install a blade sign to increase visibility. When you're walking down the street, you can't really tell that there is an ATM machine because it's through the wall. So they're proposing a blade sign that you can see from each side, double-sided, illuminated. You can see 24/7, not 24/7, sorry. You can see at night because it's 24/7 machine. That's it. Okay.
The power is feeding directly through the wall.
Yes, and all the wires are hidden on the plate of the.
So no exposed conduit or junction boxes.
Everything is. If you want, I can show you the construction drawings that shows the. It shows that all the junction box and conduit is. On the
It's not your everyday word, is that you did very well?
No, I'm actually from Brazil.
Okay, so this is, I didn't realize that.
I didn't even realize it either.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
So it's internally illuminated?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Mm-hmm. But I think it's, you guys.
The illumination it turns on I would say at 6 o'clock.
Okay.
And then it turns off as soon as
okay.
I would say that this would be on a time clock. If because there is a canopy above, otherwise we would do a photo cell, but this one will be on the time clock.
Okay.
Yes. Do you want to make a motion?
I move to issue COA for 601 Penn Street, Santander Bank. For the installation of a 2-6 by 2-6 illuminated blade sign as proposed.
I second that.
Mr. Booth?
Yes.
Ms. Weller?
Yes.
Mr. Politica?
Yes.
Okay. That's it.
Thank you for going through the process
and yes. Coming and filling out the application and doing everything the right way. Thank you.
Have a good
you
evening.
Too. Okay. We're gonna go to 501 South Fish Street. You could just sign in there, please. And your name?
John Trimble.
The Liberty Fire Company number 5 was organized in 1854 to serve the newly developed southwestern end of Reading. A two-story firehouse built in 1855 was replaced by the present building in 1876. It was then a two-story Italianate structure with a cupola. The Romanesque Revival third story was added in 1895 and is denoted by the difference in the color of the brick and the addition of wide rounded arches, broad gables, and brick bands, which contrast with the earlier verticality of the second story. The building retains its original full arch and segmental arched wood windows and original stained glass transoms at the western and northern facades. The first floor entrance on the western facade features a stained glass transom as well, depicting the building address 501, while the entrances at the northern facade feature stained glass transoms depicting the number of the fire company. Each of the two garage bays features stained glass transoms depicting Liberty, the name of the fire company. The structure has been compromised, however, with the replacement of the original entrance doors and garage bay doors. The Liberty Fire Company was placed on the National Register of Historic Places in 1984, and the structure received a site quality rating of 126, deeming it an outstanding contributing site in the Callow Hill Historic District. And tonight we are reviewing the proposal for the installation of a 30-inch by 40-inch projecting sign to read Reading Area Fire Museum in gold letters on a red background, to be mounted on a metal bracket at the first floor northern facade of the building between the two westernmost windows. And the Secretary of the Interior standards that apply to this property are number 2 and 5, which I read earlier, and the HARB sign policy. And they have been given all of the specifications. And if you just want to explain the reason for your project.
The reason putting the sign is so the public is aware that we exist. The biggest thing that we get is we didn't know you were there.
Who actually owns the building?
City of Reading.
They do.
Yes.
Okay.
Sign panel itself is high density urethane.
Correct.
Painted. It's being mounted powder coated in 40-inch brackets. How is the sign panel attached to the brackets?
There is a screw that goes through the center of the bracket down into the center of the sign.
I have no exceptions.
And this is the actual paint color
yes.
of the sign.
Yes.
Just want to show that to you. It's not always easily seen.
Yeah, the color from the computer print is
exactly.
Very
yes. simple. No, I think it's very, very nice. Mm-hmm.
One question I have is the sign maker didn't think we would need it, but we get a lot of wind since they took that warehouse down. Would there be objection if we saw in the future that we needed to put guy wires to all secure? We won't know that if it's needed until we see movement.
I guess you're not going to need it only because those mounting plates are, 4.5 inches. Sorry, it's not loading. Does anybody have that handy?
The drawing of
the mounting plate dimension. Just close.
6x6.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
And the steel tube is continuously welded to that plate.
Correct. Since that building has come down, we have taken the weathering and everything is, we've really taken a brunt from that. I can imagine so.
If something were to happen and you would see movement, just contact Ms. Johnson and then we'll have to discuss.
Because that brick is, I say it's a softer brick than versus what's on the front of the building, which is like to say a hard brick.
Right.
We're just concerned that with the wind, the size of it, and you know, more.
Okay. Does someone want to make a motion?
I make a motion to approve a COA for 501 South Pitt Street for the installation of a 30x40 projecting sign to be mounted on the north wall, as per described in the application.
So anyone want to second that?
I'll second it.
Mr. Booth?
Yes.
Ms. Weller?
Yes.
Mr. Fulton?
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Thank you
so much.
And then with the paint and stuff, that's a separate.
Yes, I'll approve that. I just haven't had a chance to, but yes, no, I'll approve that and you'll get everything as soon as I can get it to you.
Okay.
But you can start the zoning process to get your zoning permit. And I can answer any questions too.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you
for coming in. Thank you very much.
All right, 634 Center Avenue.
Built by Charles Rick Jr. in 1876, this structure is part of the Rick Row, which comprises 630 through 636 Center Avenue, where the Rick family of Rick Brothers Hardware Manufacturing Company resided until 1928. 636 Center Avenue was later removed by Calvary Reformed Church. The structure features a brick symmetrical facade with a central entranceway flanked on either side by three-story bays with segmental arch windows with window hoods on the first and second floors. The structure received a site quality rating of 116 and is an outstanding contributing site in the Center Park Historic District. And tonight we are reviewing the request for the replacement of the existing permastone at the northern facade with stucco and a smooth sand finish to be painted white. And the Secretary of the Interior guidelines that apply to this project are numbers 2, 5, and 6 of which I read earlier. And if you want to explain your project.
Well, we bought the property some time ago and actually got a nice little plaque from you guys when we did the painting over again, painting it all white and adding some purple and gray touches to it. So
you knew you were in a historic district?
Sure, okay. Sure. Yeah. We got a little bit of a grant for that. I think there was some matching funds or something. And over the years, we've had to repair that wall several times because it pushed out and water got in behind it. And so it was cracked. And you can see maybe from some of the older pictures, there's big sections that were, even when we bought it, they were just flat. They were no longer shaped like a brick or marked like a brick. Other parts somebody had tried to draw them back over the repairs. But kind of a little bit of a hodgepodge, even. The beginning, and more recently some larger pieces of it had started to fall off, and even the church had put up yellow tape to kind of keep people away from the edge of it because it was getting dangerous. So we did get Paulino Construction, who's licensed with the state for doing facade work and things like that, to come in and do the demo work. We wanted to make our application kind of simultaneous with that, but didn't happen as fast as we were planning to. So he got in there and got started. the work that he's put into it is basically demoing the stuff that was falling off and preparing with the wire mesh. I guess I'm not the contractor, so I can't say great terms, but putting the wire mesh up so that it will be a permanent fix, not something that's just plastered on top of brick. And so that's where it is now. He's stopped, but the intent would be to go the rest of the way up and put a smooth flat surface on there so that it has a better chance of repelling water. Building's already white. We're going to stay with white and just kind of keep a big surface there. The timeline, he says maybe just a couple of weeks. Maybe some 3 weeks, depending on when he's busy with something else now. It might get pushed back a little bit and he felt that he could get it up there.
I didn't get a chance to contact Chief Raria, but in the survey card that I have, that's exactly what it says, that the church had it removed. So I didn't say why, just said.
It's weird, I have some railings and other artifacts in the attic, and I can't see if I see any kind of fire residue or anything like that. So there's not any evidence of that. But they changed the whole roof line. I mean, you can see we have a very different roof line than the two to the left.
Yeah.
They used to all four be the same.
Oh, really? Okay. Interesting.
All depends on when they took it down.
Yeah.
Yeah, like I said at the time.
It seems like when they took down the other one, they totally changed my roof line. I don't exactly understand why, but
I mean the church did remove buildings behind it also for parking, and they might have been thinking about additional parking.
Well, the roof line doesn't seem like it would have that much of an effect. In fact, if you go into the attic, which is now above that little area, you can see where the wallpaper comes literally beyond the floor and almost 4 or 5 feet above the mezzanine, what I would call a mezzanine attic now. So it's kind of a cool space.
Actually, the cool spaces in the back of that row, the porches in the back, you think that you're in the city of Reading.
Oh, yeah.
You're somewhere else. You know,
it is a nice little wooden sanctuary.
Does anybody have any exceptions for cool material in the application of stucco?
No, I mean, as admirable as it was that they recreated that brick pattern in the previous application of exterior plaster.
Yeah.
It's not something that we would typically require.
Yeah. Do you see this as an in-kind replacement? Or do you think it's still different enough?
Well, that aspect is somewhat of a change. You're losing the brick pattern, but beyond the edge, the termination details, I don't really see anything to consider.
To be perfectly honest, in all the times that I've walked by that building, it wasn't until Liz mentioned that there was a brick pattern there that I ever even recognized that it was a brick pattern.
Really?
So,
yeah.
I've lived in that neighborhood
deep
for my entire life, so I've walked by there a million times.
Yeah, it doesn't have a really deep,
like
simulated mortar line. It's just
it's not like attached brick pieces or anything like that, because the thickness from where they these pieces, it's like I don't know how they did it, because that stuff dries fast, otherwise it'll sag. So they must have put it up and
it's
then troweled it or something.
Stamped it or something. Like,
stamped it. I don't know. But
it's heavy too.
Material, And it's also weird too, because the outer layer has, like, you can see it's like dark cement, but then there's like a red layer, like
just a thin, like it's almost like a sandy paint.
Maybe that's it. You can see that on the other side, because the brick pattern, the original brick pattern, doesn't match the other side.
The lines are different places.
But the outer side of the permastone, maybe that's what it is, like a red.
It's like the thickness of a sand grain.
Yeah.
That I'm calling it gritty paint.
But thicker than paint, thicker than a paint layer.
Yeah, right.
Oh, that's plaster,
yeah.
Thin
plaster or something, yeah.
But in at the end of the day, we're staying with white to match the rest of the house anyway.
Right.
I just never saw. Usually you see, like, you can see the wire lap on imprint on the back side of that.
Right.
Solid concrete. So.
Someone want to make a motion then?
I will. I move to issue COA for 634 Center Avenue for the replacement of the existing permastone with smooth stucco painted in white, so essentially as proposed.
Someone want to second that?
I'll second.
Mr. Booth?
Yes.
Ms. Wellen?
Yes.
Mr. Politica?
Yes.
Okay.
Can I make one last comment?
Oh, sure.
This is a pretty visible building. It's lovely. And just caution you to make sure that that approvals happen before work.
Yeah,
okay.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, that's my bad. I should know this because we've had worked on it in the past. That was just patchwork.
Yeah.
Didn't think we really needed it for that. But this is a bit more significant.
It's a large undertaking. Yeah. And thankfully, you're fortunate in that we have approved the work that you proposed, but could have gone a different way and a very expensive lesson to learn. So
understood. And we've got such great neighbors there next door. They've been very accommodating to get the scaffolding and the truck in there to work on it. And
that's important.
We had to take out a piece of the fence. My contractor's gonna put that back.
Thank you. We'll be watching.
Yes, yes.
All right, thank you very much.
Have a good evening.
Have a great day.
Thank you. And another backtrack unit here and go to 612 Spruce Street. Now, don't know if the board remembers this, that the previous owner was here a few months ago. We gave her the list of violations that she was to repair, and she went and sold the property.
Like a few days later.
Yeah. So now the new homeowner gets to carry this.
Of which I did meet with him today, and I don't have a property description. It's one I didn't get a chance to write anyway, but I did meet with the property owner today. And of course, I have to provide him with the list of violations, but we're only addressing the fence right now. But he did tell me that the owner made him aware that there were changes made, but she told him that she got approval. So,
nice.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yes. Wow. Yes. But the owner had emailed me since that meeting when she came. And told me that she had left all the wood windows in the building. So I haven't had a full length discussion about the violations with the owner, but I'm of course getting
stories. Yeah.
Can anyone paraphrase how the discussion went during our previous review with regard to the fence?
There was no fence.
Okay.
They have installed the fence and the three neighbors to the east have installed the same thing. So they will all be getting violation letters. He did tell me, I did ask him when the fences were installed, and he said his neighbors, he installed his first, and then all of his neighbors installed it at nighttime. So
at nighttime.
He showed me a picture because originally the fence to at 614 was right up abutted to his, but he had left the space because they all had chain link. All of the neighbors had chain link fences that were like 4 feet high, I think. And he told the neighbor that he left that space because he wasn't sure where his property line was. So
those nighttime installations can go wrong sometimes.
Yes.
So
So he, I did ask him, there in the pictures I gave you, there are two fence panels missing, and that's because he wants to install a gate, but he wants to install a sliding gate. I don't even know. Well, he's been denied. He obviously wants to park behind
the building. Can't park back there on the dirt.
He will be approved for parking if he provides proof that he's going to and gives all the dimensions for providing a parking service. But it has to be, yes. But that is all up to the zoning office. So just for the fence, he wants to install in that empty space a sliding gate, but he has not researched how it's going to look yet because he wanted approval to know if he could get approval first for the style of fencing that is there. So he didn't want to proceed without having.
Well, great analysis can accept it to approve those type of fences in the past. So.
Or it has, yes.
So as long as the gate is the same
style. Yes, the gate will be the same style. It'll just be a sliding back on itself.
What about the other violations? We have to bring them back for that?
Yes. Or I'll start out with providing them all to him, and then he has to work from there. But Yeah, the violations will be addressed separately.
Okay. Are the posts also vinyl?
Yes. Yeah. That's what it looks like.
Do they have a cap?
You know, when I was out there, I did not honestly pay attention to that, but it looks like they are kind of sheared off. So
do you have that picture of the note that shows all the neighbors? Is there a visible difference with the cap?
No, they're all,
the same. What was thinking?
Usually it comes with a cap to insert in there. Lately, it's been LED lights.
little solar lights or something like that. Yeah.
No.
The neighboring ones do have.
Some. You can see a little domed cap there. Yeah.
But
yeah,
I don't think
it's
theirs
too.
That's
a good.
Maybe doing it in the daytime is not the right way to go.
You got the details right when you do it at night.
That would be my own.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, when the last time the fence policy was reviewed, I was not in favor of vinyl fences.
Okay.
But it's according to the policy, it's approved.
Yeah. And it's out there. We've heard quite a few of them.
Yeah.
I mean, we always, or board usually tries to steer people towards a wood fence, but we have approved, I think, in the end, and all the storage. I know we've approved in Center Park.
Yeah. I think in most of them.
Several times, yeah.
So is the COA for just the fence or the fence and the gate?
Gate should be separate. Just the fence.
Yeah, I guess just the fence, and then make him come back. So then he can research how to do the gate, if it's even feasible to do the sliding gate, and have him come back.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to approve something you don't even know what it's going to look like.
Yeah.
And
so
it's going to match the vinyl that's existing.
Yeah, but the style, like maybe he could even do two doors that open. We were talking about one door that would open, that would swing out, that would just not be feasible. But if you want to do two doors that swing open, that's a possibility too.
He
can't fit a car back there. He's not supposed to put a car back there.
He's not supposed to right now.
Right.
He told the zoning inspector, translated for me, and he said that because my pictures show that there's cars right there, and he said, oh, I only had them there for a few minutes. But so they're watching that, and he did make a comment about opening the gates out because it's an alley, and that it might impede traffic flow.
True.
So that's why he wants
the
sliding gate.
So he does want a sliding
gate.
He didn't mention that.
Yes.
Okay.
And he talked about it would have to be on a track, like, or maybe have a track at the base of it somehow, but that's all he's
a lot of pictures of the mammoth.
Okay. I know Cindy Lasota does not have a vinyl fence, but
doesn't she have a sliding gate?
Yeah, it's metal.
It's metal.
Okay. Yeah, all right. It's like, it's not wrought iron, but aluminum.
Yeah, aluminum. Yeah,
okay.
Does someone want to make a motion?
So I propose to issue a COA for 612 Spruce Street for the installation of 6 foot high white vinyl fence at the rear yard. The applicant should finish the installation with the top caps on the posts, and should return with an application for the installation of the gate, style of installation of the gate. That's good.
Someone want to second that?
I'll second that.
Good. Mr. Booth?
Yes.
Ms. Weller?
Yes.
Mr. Politiker?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm just looking at the applications approved by staff for a second. I saw some of this work being done and saw this today.
Oh,
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
What is this 501 South Fifth Street?
That's the painting.
Yeah.
So
okay.
Approving the painting. It's the Liberty Fire Company.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I thought. Okay, so that's the
It's just okay. I always separate out unless I want the board
to review that, right?
The potential staff approved item, but I'll separate it out on agenda.
Just to let the board know that I wasn't really aware of this before, but I guess the HARB will be giving a 18 month report in August to City Council. And Ms. Johnson and I decided that we would do the commendation at the same time, so we don't have to go two separate times. Anything from the Education and Outreach Committee report?
We need
staff approval. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's fine. I'll do that.
Okay.
I make a motion to approve staff application.
Sorry. No. All in favor?
Aye.
Bear with me 1 second. Education and Outreach Committee report. Policy Committee report.
The only thing would be based on our discussion this evening. We want to add language to Chapter 295 in the list of exceptions for a certificate of appropriateness within the conservation districts. I believe the suggestion was to add carports to that list.
Yeah. And sheds.
okay. as well. Yeah.
And the other, only other thing that is, that I run into that is confusing is letter F reads fences, commas, walls not exceeding 4 feet in height, comma, gates, comma, arbors, and trellises. And people get tripped up on reading, like, even though it doesn't say fences and walls, it's, and I don't know how to remedy that yet, but to make it clear that it's fences, period, not fences. It sounds like it's fences not exceeding 4 feet in height, but it's any fence. Yeah, that's what our intention was. So I don't know if it should be, I mean, we don't have to discuss it now, but all fences or something. But whenever I'm constantly getting questioned on, well, do fences over 4 feet in height require review?
Yeah.
Just the way it reads now. So those,
it should say all fences.
Yeah,
okay.
I think so.
Okay, all fences, sorry.
And then I can say that, something better. Or maybe fences is separated out.
Well, does the same apply to walls then? Like if it's more than 4 feet in height, are we reviewing it then?
According to the
we should, right?
Well, walls not exceeding 4 feet in height. So if it's 4 feet and under, we don't.
Right.
But if it's over 4 feet, according to this,
we should. Like if somebody wanted to do a stone wall or some sort of
retaining wall
around
their house.
Right. Yeah. Right. A snow fortress, that's all. Yeah. And a moat we have, please. Put moat in there too. Yeah.
Well, and so
in my castle.
Shouldn't gates, trellises, and arbors, the trellises and arbors, that should almost be its own line.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah. I mean, they're
fences and
they're
gates go
decorative.
Together.
Yes. Yeah.
Walls is
yes.
Right. Thing.
Right. Yeah.
And then
arbors and trellises.
Trellises, arbors. That's a separate line. So there's three separate lines there.
So wait, fences and gates.
Yep.
Walls. Yeah.
Walls not more than 4 feet in height. Trellises and arbors. Carports,
shed,
and then shed as a separate line.
Yeah, that's probably good.
Like that.
So they don't seem connected when they're really kind of separate, but similar.
I'll make that motion.
Okay.
Oh.
And
done. Policy done, right?
Well, I'll type this up and send it out to you for final
okay.
approval, but we can make a motion or you. Right now.
So I mean, if everybody wants to wait to see the
draft.
Yeah,
let's see the final
Okay. That will help immensely because that fence and wall thing trips me a lot.
I read it today again. I think I even got a little confused by what that meant. Yeah.
And
just one thing that the fence shows me with all those vinyl fences going down the alley is, it's not that, you want to be, I'm guilty with myself because when I put my fence in my backyard, I put a 6 foot high shadow fence up all the way back. So I'm in my own back little yard. It's nice. But the flip side of it is if everyone does that, then who knows what's in there,
True.
Not that you should be peeping Tom to find out what's going on in there, But at the same point in time, I have a well-maintained backyard. That doesn't necessarily mean everybody else does.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that's the city encourages actually people to put slabs and cement in the backyards and can park their cars back there. And that's a shame actually in a way because backyards are sometimes be really, really cool.
They still have to maintain 25% pervious surface. So it doesn't mean they can pave their whole entire backyard. But yes, they are encouraging it to get cars off.
That's why dogs are in the middle of the night. That's why, because I know there's a couple in my backyard and down in my back alley that, there's a garage in the back and they just cemented the rest of it and they just parked right there. It's all open. Who's going to stop them? So,
And it's not just like it's just not shortage of parking, it's also security for your car too.
Yeah.
True.
Getting
your
property dedicated or fenced or whatever.
True.
I get that.
They get a lot of requests for
Doing
that.
A lot of vandalism.
Okay, so I'll draft that up and I'll send it to you for approval at the next meeting.
Yeah, sounds good.
But I think that will be
Yeah.
I think everything, all the other wording covers everything. And I haven't had any issues that I can think of right
now. I even asked if that place set required, but it didn't. There was no something required.
There's place set.
All right, do we have a motion to adjourn?
Did we go through the preservation officers?
I did not have
I didn't know if there was anything.
Okay,
if there were any updates. Sorry.
That's okay.
Yeah.
No, thank you.
Okay. You made a motion to adjourn.
I'll second.
I third you.
All in favor.
All right.
Can you?